So, my talk will first start with an introduction in which I will show you the equation we are solving in reservoir simulation, and I will present you also the specifics of the linear system we are solving. Then I will present you some results of the work on the algebraic multigrid, which is today the reference solver that preconditioner that is used for the pressure part in our systems. So this was a more an engineering problem where we have tried to put some different ingredients that we found in the AMG literature to improve the scalability of AMG for reservoir simulation. And then I will present you another approach, which consists now to start from a very scalable preconditioner and use some and try to apply some idea of LoRa on the enlarged Krylov method that USAM is trying to apply to GEMRES and to reservoir simulation. And then I will give you some conclusion on prospect on this project. So first. So what we are trying to do in reservoir simulation is to model the fluid flows underground. So what we have is a tentative model of the work properties that we have obtained through different knowledge from seismic and from the wells we are drilling, which give us some more accurate properties on the rocks. So what we are trying to do, so in this model, we have some wells. We have some injection wells where we put some water, we inject some water, and you have some production wells where you expect to get some oil or gas, depending on the field. And the major role of reservoir simulation is to try to predict what will be the production obtained in oil or gas at the production wells. In particular, what we want to forecast is how much oil you can recover from a field. So, of course, this is an important economical question for us. So typically, what we have is that for each well, we have some curves, which are the production of oil and the production of water. So at first, we only produce oil. This is the plateau of production. And then we will start to have water. We have a water breakthrough that comes from the injection wells that goes to the production wells. And what we try to do is to match our numerical models with what we have observed on the field. So we have usually a long history of data concerning each well, and we try to obtain the same on this history. We try to match the result by adjusting the different property of the reservoir to adjust the result of the simulation on the realistic measures. So this is what we call the history matching. So this requires a lot of run in order to match these results. And then when we have done that, we can start doing some forecast based on the model we have obtained. Another typical problem that we have is that in some situation we want to do some we want to do some enhanced oil recovery technique, which means that we are not only injecting water, we can do more complex stuff. For example, if you have some very viscous oil, in this case, you can put polymer, for example, in the water in order to increase the viscosity of the water. And we want to model this. And this is quite complex because the water plus polymer becomes a non-Newtonian fluid. And the physics is quite complex to model. So for example, here, I have a small video, that a small movie that shows the injection of water into viscous oil. And what you see is that we call viscous fingering, which is a complex physics phenomenon to capture in the fluid. So for this kind of simulation, we usually need a very big model because you need to capture the perturbation at a very small scale to get these fingers. So now let's look at the equation we are solving. So they are rather simple in terms of mathematics because what we have at the continuous level is a material balance. So what says only that we have this equation here with the flux, the velocity of the fluid. Here you have the density, of course, what goes into a cell's, the material variation inside a cell is linked to the flux, and you have a source term that comes from usually the wells. And of course, the other equation we have is the Darcy laws that control the fluid motion in porous media. So what we know, the Darcy laws in monophasic, you have only this term that is only varying in space. But when you have multiphasic fluids, because we have oil, water, gas, then you have this term, which is relative permeability, and which is very complex in some cases, because first it depends on saturation, and it can also depends on the history in time, on the history of saturation in the cells. So it can be very complex to in terms of numerics to get the right modelization because of this term. So the Darcy laws just say that the velocity of the fluid depends on the gradient of pressure between two cells. So from the discretization of those equations are made in most of the industrial simulators using a finite volume scheme. So there is no good reason to use this scheme except that we have it is a conservative scheme, but we could also consider other schemes. The most important reason is legacy from what we have before, in fact, to use this scheme. And once you have discrete this, then you write for each cell a mass balance where is F is the flux that goes into the cell, the cells. Here you have the variation of material in the cells, and here you have the source term. And of course, what we try to do so when is to have at the nonlinear level is to nullify the residual at each time step to know how have varies the saturation inside each cells. So we have a very classic scheme in terms of simulation. We have we usually do implicit simulation. So the implicit unknown are the pressure and the saturation. In some situation, it is possible to use an impasse scheme. In example, for when we have complex physics and we know we have reason to have a time step that do not violate the CFL condition. But in most of the time, on a real reservoir field, we use a fully implicit scheme. So you have a Newton loop. And of course, inside this loop, after you have linearized your equation, the most CPU time-consuming stage is the solving of the linear system. And this is what we are going to look at in the next slides. So one of the big challenges in reservoir simulation is that we don't have something, we don't have simulations that scales very well. So the main reason for that is, as we will see, is due to the solver. And as you can see here, so this is the scalability curve for some typical reservoir simulation. So this line here is for the biggest model. It was for 13 million cells model. So at this point, you have around 50,000 cells per core. And as you can see, the scalability is rapidly decreasing. And what we try is to, of course, improve this situation because, as I said before, we have many runs to do for the history matching, for example. So if we look at the parallel algorithm we have to use, except for the solver, the parallelism is fairly simple in the reservoir because we have a finite volume scheme, so it is a very classical scheme because you need to compute some derivative for each cell, and you need the neighbor cells to compute this derivative. So what you usually do to compute this derivative that builds a Jacobian matrix is that you use this simple scheme with Gauss cells that you need to communicate at each iteration to compute this derivative. So for this part, it's really simple. So the complex part, of course, is a linear solver where you have many communication. And as you see, when you have a parallel computation, most of the time is spent in the linear solver. So it can amount to 60, but even up to 80% of the computations. So now let's look at the linear solver we are dealing with. So what we have usually two parts in the linear solver. So here is the part related to the reservoir grid. So this means each cell represents part of the space on the underground rocks. So here, for each cell, as I said before, you have some mass balance equation to write with the flux obtained by combining the Darcy laws on the mass balance. And what you do is that for each phase, you have one mass balance equation to write. And the last equation here is a sum. The last equation is a sum of all the mass balance equation. And usually we align the last column in each cell with the pressure unknown. So this part is the reservoir, concerns the reservoir grid. And here you have a coupling with the Wells equation. So usually here what you have is that something that depends on the complexity of the network, because you can have a surface network that connects the wells. So, but if you don't have a network surface, it's just a diagonal. And here, a wells, of course, goes through many cells, so it connects many cells from the reservoir grids. So the specificity of the reservoir systems is that they combine an elliptic part that comes from the pressures unknown, with some transport from the saturations unknown. And the ID of the reference linear method that is used since the 80s in a reservoir simulation that is called CPR, for constraint pressure residual, is to try to separate the elliptic part of the system from the transport part. So the idea of the method is to, I've done a permutation with on the right, where I have put all the pressure unknown at the end of the system, so you can see a subsystem that only concerns the pressures unknown. And what we do is to obtain a good approximation of the Shaw complement here, obtained by eliminating all this unknown in this system. Well, you all know that if we do that exactly here, we end up with a full system, which of course is not solvable in a good amount of time. So the idea is in fact to obtain a Shaw complement that is close to the real one, or at least that gives some solution that are not bad compared to the real pressure solution, but that is still sparse. So to do that, in fact, the idea is to replace this matrix here by a diagonal, and this matrix here by a diagonal. Because if you do that here, this matrix has the same pattern than this one, and where, when you eliminate this equation into this one here, you don't change the sparsity pattern of this matrix. So the diagonal matrix here is obtained by a block column sum of all the cells. And in this part, also, we sum all the cells in the column into the diagonal. And this is linked to the... This has some physical meanings because of all of these coupling terms are, in fact, some derivative of the flux from the derivative of the flux compared to the saturations. And so what we do, in fact, is to end up, by doing that, we end up with a system, a pressure system that is close to the one we would obtain with an implicit scheme in pressure and explicit in saturation. So this is why this approximation is quite good, in fact, for the pressure subsystem. So once you have obtained this system, you solve the pressure part, you have a tentative solution for the pressure unknown, and then you reinject them in the global system by just a simple extension. And here you apply a second preconditioner that is usually very simple, like LU0, block LU0, so block a block for each domain, just to smooth the solution at the global level. So what you have is a general FGMRS method at the outer level, with a preconditioner that consists in two phases. The first phase is to solve this system that is close to M matrix. It is not symmetric, but it is close to a symmetric matrix with a positive eigenvalue. So what we usually do here is to use an algebraic multigrid method, which is a reference method today for such system, and then you apply the second part of the preconditioner here, which is a simple LU0. So, at each iteration of the CPR preconditioner, what you have is you decouple the pressures unknown from the other unknowns, and then since we don't need a very accurate solution for the pressure, you usually only need one V cycle of multigrid at the pressure level to get this approximate pressure solution. Because what we want at the preconditioner level is to capture the low frequency mode of the error that are only due to the pressure part of the system. So to capture this low frequency mode, we usually only need a very few V-cycle of AMG. And of course, this is a critical part of the solver, because as you may know, AMG is a very weakly scalable solver. Okay, that is to say, if you increase the size of your model with the number of processors you are using, then you usually achieve a very good scalability, that is to say, the time will remain quite constant. But for strong, in terms of strong scalability, is not very good, essentially because the first levels of AMG, so remind you of the principle of AMG. So the principle of AMG is to construct some algebraic projector from the initial grid to get some smaller model. So you restrict, you construct a restrictor from your original system to get a smaller one. And the role at each level of this, at each level, you apply a simple preconditioner that is called a smoother to capture the frequency that are seen at this level of the grid. So of course, the smoother at the first level are capturing the high frequency component of the error. And when you go to the coarser system, you capture lower and lower frequency of your error. And of course, the algebraic multigrid, like the original geometric multigrid, have the properties that they are optimal. That is to say that they usually scale linearly with the dimension of your problem. But the problem, of course, is that the algorithm to construct this restrictor are quite complex, because you have to choose for each time you have a new system, these restrictors depends on the coefficient of the matrix. So if you recall the Newton loop, at each iteration of the Newton, potentially, we need to recompute this hierarchy. And of course, you need communication to do that. And for the solving phase also, but especially for the setup phase, where you construct all the grid, you have many communication. And here, you can see what happens if you use too many cores. Then at the coarser level, you end up by only doing communication. So you lose the scalability. So typically, on the time in a reservoir simulation is are largely spent in the AMG solver. So here you can see on this graph the time for each number of MPI process. So we use also thread inside the for each MPI process. We use a certain number of cores using threads. So usually what we do is to put one MPI process per CPU socket, and we use all the core in the socket using threads, which is usually the better strategy. And here, what you can see is the scalability obtained for each number of process. We have multiplied the time by the number of process. So a perfect scalability would mean that each part of the algorithm would remain, would cause the same thing on this graph at each for each number of core. And as you can see, as the number of core increase, the part of the AMG spent in the part of time spent in the AMG is increasing really fast compared to the other part. So this part of the other stuff that we do in CPR are neglectable compared to what we do in the AMG, and what is done inside the other part of the simulator is also pretty scalable. So what we have done is to try to enhance the AMG solver. So this work was done with in collaboration with Sarfax. So we had Pavel that for 1 year and a half was in Sarfax. So he was looking at all the AMG algorithms that exist in the literature. Especially, you have two main classes of AMG. You have aggregation strategy that are based on a different grid construction than the classical AMG. So the classical AMG grids are constructed by finding some coarse node among the fine grid models, and then you have some you construct some restrictor on the coarse node from the fine node. And the aggregation is more a strategy, a more aggressive strategy to construct the grid, where you construct some sort of a little domain, and then you have some simple restrictors on those. You assign one coarse node for each small domain you have created, and you have some different numerical criterion to choose the coarse node, and here the way to construct this small domain in the AMG. So the main difference between the two approaches is that here you usually have less level in the AMG, so this means that you have less communication to do. But the reverse of the medal is that usually you end up with a worse convergence than in the classical AMG scheme. So the main result that was obtained by trying some different AMG strategy was that it was better for reservoir system, the pressure system, to begin the grid hierarchy by using some aggressive aggregation for the first two levels or first three levels, and then to switch to the classic strategy. This is mainly due because in reservoir we have a strong anisotropy in our model because it's because of the geometry. Well, because we have very thin cells in terms of real physical dimension compared to the surface we have in the Z direction. So this means that we have a very strong coupling in the Z direction in our model, and the aggregation algorithm, they works very, very well when we have such situation, because here you usually can decrease very rapidly the number of unknown in your coarse grid. So by combining these two ideas, and also by using some strategies that consist to keep the restriction and the prolongation operators that you have construct, for example, at the beginning of a Newton iteration for the rest of the Newton iteration, then you have some good improvement compared to what we have been able to obtain, for example, with a Boomer AMG, which is the reference package for algebraic multigrid. So here you have the time spent in a log scale in the pressure resolution in the CPR algorithm. So the dashed line corresponds to the package that has been that Pavel has written. It's the multigrid package that he has written. So this multigrid package combines the idea of aggregation and classical coarsening, but it also allows. So this is the difference between the green curve, for example, and the blue curve. Yeah, it allows also to reuse the restriction and prolongation operator. So on small models, like this one was a 1 million domain, we get this speed up compared to the best parameter tuning we could achieve with a Boomer MG. So this is not a very big improvement on such model, on such a small model, because most of the improvements were made at the first level of the algorithm. On here, on this curve, the model is not big enough to have a lot of time spent in the first levels of the model. But if we look at much bigger models, this one is 60 million models, then we have been able to achieve, in the case where we compute the setup at each iteration, we were able to achieve a factor 2 with 8,000 cores on this kind of a model, and by reusing the grid hierarchy for several linear system, we were able to achieve a 5 time speed up. So, but we have not yet answered to the real problem of scalability, because as you can see here, the scalability is still very poor compared to the number of processors. So now the idea is to take another approach. So in the previous approach, we have started from the complex parallel strategy of MG, and we have tried to simplify it into to obtain something that is more scalable. So now the idea was to apply some work that has been done, some ideas that has been developed earlier by Laura, that was to start from a very scalable preconditioner, but we want to combine them with some enlarged Krylov method that consists to have a Krylov method that that is more efficient in parallel than the traditional one. So I have used some slides that Laura gave me for this part. So if we look at the classical GMRS algorithm, we know that most of the parallel communication are due to the matrix vector multiplication, and all the dot product that you need for the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization of the Krylov space, and also the dot product need to obtain some norm in the algorithm. So of course, when you have more and more core, when you use more and more core to parallelize this algorithm, this part that costs nothing in serial, they are the real bottleneck of the GMRS method. So this is what we want to reduce. And one thing you have to keep in mind is that in terms of parallelization, what matters in this case is the number of messages you are doing, not really the volume of data you are doing. It's more how much message you are doing in the algorithm that kills the scalability. So the idea of the enlarged Krylov method comes from the blocks GMRS method. You all know that you probably know that if you have a system with multiple right hand side, so that is to say that you have several linear systems to solve, but the matrix is the same. It is more efficient to combine the Krylov space information that you get from the GMRS algorithm for each system than to solve them independently. So the idea in parallel is to use this combination of Krylov space by creating artificially multiple right-hand side system. So typically what you have you distribute the rows of your matrix using a graph partition. So here, this is a picture of a typical matrix you have in parallel, where each processor will get some rows of the matrix associated to a domain. So on the diagonal, usually you have a lot of non-zero term, and then you have the coupling between the domains here that are quite sparse. And the idea is to consider the multiple right-hand side that is obtained by dividing. So you have one system to solve with one right-hand side, and by dividing this right-hand side into several right-hand side, where you have null terms on all the domain except one domain. Okay. So this is the multiple right-hand side we will try to solve in parallel. And of course, when you have solved all of this system, then you get the solution of your initial system by just summing all the solution. Okay. So what is the interest of that? In fact, you have a larger Krylov space at each iteration. You do the same number of messages in your Krylov algorithm, but since you have more vectors in your Krylov space, you converge, you improve your convergence. And so, ultimately, you have less communication in parallel. So this is the main ingredient of this method. So if we look at the Jamois algorithm, what changed, in fact, is mostly the what happens when you do the matrix vector multiplication, because now what we have is a multiplication with several vector at one time. So of course this works if you have a precondition Jamois also. Here you replace A by the precondition matrix. So you need to have a multiple right-hand side preconditioner. So what changed is this matrix vector multiplication, and also the classical Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization. So here what you do is a block Gram-Schmidt algorithm, and what changed compared to the original algorithm is that you need, in addition, to orthogonalize all the new Krylov vector you have added at the current iteration. So here, what we use is a QR algorithm that does a low amount of communication. On this version is a tall, skinny QR. So this is the basic starting idea of the first idea of enlarged Jamois. And of course, you can do more than that. So what is interesting is that during the Krylov, the iteration, you have some system, so you have multiple right-hand side system that will converge. So for this system, you don't have to compute the Krylov system anymore. So this is to say that you need to detect the converged part of your multiple right-hand side system. So this means that during the iteration, you will need to add less and less Krylov vector. And another interesting property is that for the parts that have converged, then you have a good estimation in the Krylov space of the eigenvalue and eigenvectors, and you can use them to do some deflation at the Jamois level. So now what Hussam has tried to do is to combine these two ideas in Jamois to make some tests on the reservoir on some reservoir system. So for now, he has mostly worked on prototyping in MATLAB. So from some systems that come from a real reservoir simulator. And what we can see here on these two graphs, so on the left graph, what you see is the number of iterations. So the accuracy asked was pretty strong for this kind of system, but it was done on purpose to see all the convergence behavior. So what you have on the left side is the number of Krylov vector you are adding at each iteration for a different number of domain. Okay, so each color represents the convergence of a system with a fixed number of domain in the enlarged Krylov subspace. So this means that the more domain you have, the more vector you add at each iteration. So you can see, so the first curve correspond to a classical GMRS, and then you have the curve for 2, 4, 8, 16, and 32 domains. And in order to compare fairly all this variation, what is done is that we fixed the number of Krylov vectors we allow ourselves to keep in the Krylov base and in the deflation. So here it was fixed to 400 vector. So when you compare all this method, you have the same amount of memory that is used. So you can see that the convergence obtained by adding more domain at the Krylov level is better, of course, because you add more Krylov vector at each iteration. And so this is what you can see on the left. So here you have this kind of artifact that are due to the fact that since we have a limitation to 400 vectors, sometimes when you end the cycle, then you are only allowed to add two vectors, for example. So here, suddenly you can have a sudden drop in the number of vector you are adding at the iteration. And what you can see here is that the decreasing at the end corresponds to the fact that many of the systems have converged. Okay. So the interesting part is that in fact, the more domain you have, the better the convergence can be with this algorithm without increasing the number of messages. And the preconditioner used here was the block Jacobi, but in order to have a proper comparison, of course, the block Jacobi, the number of domain used in the block Jacobi was fixed. Okay? We have a partition for the enlarged Krylov method, and the block Jacobi method was fixed to a fixed number of 128 domains. So here on this slide, what you see is to stress out the effect of deflation. So as I said before, one interesting property is that we can extract some eigenvalue and eigenvector information from the Krylov iteration. So what has been done here is to compare the enlarged GMRS algorithm. So first, with a restarting strategy without any deflation between each cycle, that is to say we restart the Krylov space at the beginning, at each cycle. And then we have compared in these two curves the convergence obtained at each end at each restart. We have compared the method that does deflation at each restart, so that compute some eigenvalue approximation from the previous cycle, and the method where you do no restart in the enlarged Helmholtz method. As you can see, the deflection algorithm is pretty effective because we have almost the same convergence between these two curves. And another interesting property is that if you solve again the system by you, from a previous with a different right-hand side, and by using the previous information obtained from the eigenvector at the previous solving, then you have an even better convergence. And this is very interesting for reservoir simulation, because as I said to you, when during, for example, a Newton iteration, but even for several time step, we have a slow evolution of the pressure subsystem. So what is very interesting is that we can keep some eigenvalue that has been obtained from the previous iteration. Okay, so this is something we want to look into more detail with Sam and Laura. So this is my conclusion. So I have presented you the main challenge in reservoir simulation in terms of HPC, which mostly are due to the linear solver. We have tried to improve the reference method, which is for the pressures, which is today the algebraic multigrid. So we have tried to combine, in fact, many ingredients that we have found in the literature and to get some improvement. And now we have started since last year with Hussam this work on the enlarged Krylov method, where the approach is to start from a very simple preconditioner, but we want to have some more efficient strategy at the Krylov level by reusing some information of the spectra of our matrix using what has been done earlier in the iteration. And of course, later, if this is not sufficient, we will try to improve also the preconditioner, to combine that with a better preconditioner. But first, we want to start from a very scalable approach. And now the work that we are planning to do with Hussam and Laura is to see that in real situation, in reservoir simulator, because for now, Hussam has done a lot of theory to prove many of the things I've just show you. Now the work we are planning to do here in SEMRAX is mostly to define the interface for the C++ code of Hussam in order to integrate that easily in the reservoir simulator. And we will also look more closely at how to reuse, in fact, the eigenvalue approximation, or eigenvector approximation in the subsequent system we are solving in the reservoir simulator. So thank you for your attention. Oops, sorry.